सहनावतु सहनोभुनक्तु सहवीर्यं करवावहै तेजस्विनावधीतमस्तु मा विद्विषावहै ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः। ॐ योगेन चित्तस्य पदेन वाचा मलं शरीरस्य च वैद्यकेन योपाकरोत्तं प्रवरम् पदञ्जलिं प्राञ्जलिरानतोऽस्मि पदञ्जलिं प्राञ्जलिरानतोऽस्मि। ॐ शान्ति शान्ति शान्तिः। श्री सद्गुरु महाराज की जय। बेसिकली देर आर टू मेथड्स टू अटेन असंप्रज्ञात समाधि। The first one is based on, depending on birth. So some get some previous connections, so with that they proceed further. They are called bhava pratyayas. By birth, they are qualified for asambrajñata. Then comes upaya pratyayas. They are depending on systematic progress. They have to follow some systematic sadhana procedure, then they attain it. So we are all in this group. So depending on sadhana. Now systematic progress needs step by step progress. So what are the steps? What are the qualifications they need for their sadhana? So that is, we chanted the sutra 120. Shraddha Virya Smriti Samadhi Prajna Purvaka Itaresham. Itaresha means for others who are different from Bhava Pratyayas. For them, there is a fivefold systematic sadhana system, fivefold. First is Shraddha. Shraddha basically means faith and trust, confidence, belief, all those things. Actually, for Shraddha, there is no correct word, corresponding word in English. We say faith. There is some difference between faith and Shraddha. Shraddha is not only faith, what we understand by word faith in English. Faith, you see, faith is a mental tendency. It mind makes the mental tendency it is. But this bhakti, related to bhakti and shraddha, shraddha is a mental action. The mental tendency, when we say, it happens whenever it needs. We have faith in our social system. We have faith in our parents. We have faith in our education system. We believe whatever they educate is right. We have faith in our food we eat. So this is all just a tendency mind creates. Generally, everybody has this faith. But Shraddha is connected to bhakti, the devotion, then it changes. It's a mental action. This is knowingly produced. It has a separate awareness. While faith has no separate awareness. Faith is just you are believing on something very special. So it is little more stronger than belief, just belief. There is something more in that, but it is not correct what we say as Shraddha. The Shraddha has faith with love and respect. Faith with love and respect. So this is something higher than faith. That is why I added the word. You have some awareness about that. You make it. So that is mental action, and the faith is mental tendency. When we say tendency, it happens. There is no need for awareness. If you have a tendency to react over something, you react, just you react. That is a tendency to react. The fear, you are afraid of many things, that is also a tendency. Such are called tendencies. But here it is not a tendency which happens there. So the bhakti is connected to Shraddha. Shraddha, no, bhakti is with Shraddha. Bhakti is devotion. It's translated as devotion. Devotion means you have to specially remember. There we have unconditional love and respect. Complete dedication. So devotion generally means you are devoted to something. You are devoted to a person. You are devoted to the job you do. So I am devoted to my job. In English, it says like that. Because I am just taking these points, because otherwise you will misunderstand. You will not know the exact meaning of that. We use the same word in English, but the meaning is something different what we want to say. and there is communication gap. So I am devoted to job and I am devoted to God. What is the difference? There is a big difference. So that difference is, you are devoted to God without a condition, with love and respect. You are devoted to the job, what you do is with condition. If the job is not getting enough salary, enough income, your devotion is gone, now you will change the job. Nowadays, youngsters, they change the job every year or sometimes every month. So they are searching for new jobs. So it means that devotion is with condition. So it cannot be translated as devotion, the word. And for bhakti, there is no correct word in English. So bhakti is a mix of love and respect and devotion unconditionally. There is no condition. It's forever. Once you start bhakti with devotion with God, it lasts forever. Something happening or not? No. You are not going to change your devotion towards God. So this meaning is not correctly understood when we pronounce the word devotion. So we should be careful when we deal with such textbooks, when we study this, because the limitation with the language and cultural difference, you have to understand. That is the problem when we speak in English. You have to find correct word or you have to translate it. It's like the difference we want to see, faith and Shraddha, you have to say like this, the mental action and mental tendency. So tendency is something everybody understands. And action means knowingly you do. You have Shraddha, you know that why I am having this Shraddha towards my Guru, towards the God, towards the study. So because you love it and you respect it unconditionally. So this is a must for any sadhagas. If he is a bhakti yogi, jnana yogi, or hatha yogi, or whatever yogi he may be, but you must have this Shraddha. People say there is no bhakti. Bhakti is not connected to jnana and hatha yoga. Now you can see here in this portion, this yoga is connected to bhakti because bhakti is a basic character that one needs to overcome from all tendencies. So without bhakti, it is not possible. Surrender. So this way, Shraddha is very important. Here Vyasa Bhashya says, Sahi Jananiva Kalyani Yoginam Prati. Sahi, this Shraddha is like a loving mother for a yogi who is practicing yoga sadhana. So he is giving so much importance to Shraddha. The Vyasa Deva, Sahi Jananiva Kalyani Yoginam Pati. He protects like a mother. So protecting like a mother means she loves so much. So same thing, the Shraddha also protects the yogi, the sadhaka. That is one important sadhana. Then comes virya. Virya is strength of willpower. It's not physical strength. Because here the sadhanas are connected to mind. It's all mental sadhanas. The Shraddha is also mental and viryam is willpower. So when from willpower you get tremendous energy to fulfill your desires. Without viryam, without this willpower, he cannot complete a job. You cannot undertake any of the sadhanas. You need willpower. First to decide what to do. And then be clear about the goal you want to achieve. And study and understand what is that goal is. So then you will have the willpower to practice and achieve it. So this is also necessary. If you don't have willpower, then you are weakened. Now how to improve this willpower is, just try to understand your ego. Reduce unnecessary thoughts and reduce egoism, then you will get the right willpower. People say the self-esteem and the willpower is correlated. If you have a personality with high esteem, then you have a willpower of high level willpower. But that is not true. Surrendering also can give willpower. If you surrender your ego, also you get willpower. Because when you surrender your ego, your personalities, your limitations are not boundaries. Now you are with ego and self-esteem, that is a boundary made by you. It is limitation. So you are delimited with that condition, that I am in this, I am so and so. I have this much money, I have this much power, my body is like this, my mind is like this, I can only do this, I can only do that. So you make all the conditions. Then you cannot think about doing something very high. It is impossible for you. This is a problem with ego. Actually, ego gives you this suggestion. You go for this, go for that, don't go for that, don't go for this. This you cannot do. Who said you cannot do that? It is possible. You have the energy, you have the mind, you have the intellect. You can make the willpower if you surrender ego to the all-pervading God or the consciousness which we experience, that Almighty. So the Almighty will give you the strength. So then your will is connected to the will of universal will. So then it is happening. This is something miracle that you have to understand logically. But here the virya comes mentally by this willpower. Now third thing is smriti. Smriti is, here smriti is not only memory. Smriti is a retentive power, that whatever you study, whatever you practice, or what experience you have by practicing, you remember all those. You take strength from that. We can say mindfulness. Mindfulness for doing anything. The here specially sadhana is mentioned. So mindfulness towards sadhana. So this is here smriti is. So smriti also gives strength. When we undertake some new action, we are always thinking forward to complete it. That is the normal process. You think forward to complete it. So this is new action I have undertaken, I have to do this, that, and then it will be completed. But with that, when you undertake a new action, it's okay, you look forward to complete it. But with that, you must think, you must remember your previous actions and what you gained from that. All the positive things you did in your previous practices. Why it is necessary? Because those actions, that the impressions of those actions are there in your mind, and it is also going to give a connection to new actions. You cannot do a new action completely new. It is connected to previous action. So you have done much in your previous life. So just remember those, even small things, you can remember those. Then the mind is fully settled for new undertaking. Otherwise, you will be more anxious about the forthcoming developments. What will happen after this? So you will have some doubt over it. So if you connect with the previous one, then it is easy for mind to act. That is one thing. The second thing is, with this smriti, mindfulness, what does this mindfulness means? When you undertake a new action, you just plan it from the beginning to end. Repeat it. Like you are making a plan for buildings, you make a master plan, then a model of it, then you undertake the work and finish it. So exactly the same way, when you undertake any of the new actions, just plan step by step. People say, you just start action, then it will happen whatever is happened. That is another thing. That is, that I will say in another way, that is something else. It is not correct. When you take even a small action, you try to visualize it, how it is going to develop and how it is going to end. The complete thought process. So once the thought process is completed, and repeat it again. The benefit is, this become a suggestion, a plan model for subconscious mind to work on it. Because when you make the plan completely and give, then that is easy for subconscious mind to protect you and give you the energy to complete the plan. This is very practical and it's a psychological fact also. What we say, you just start, then everything will happen. That is related to little bit miracle. say miracle, if it is happening, is okay. Otherwise, it is also okay. It means your willpower is only to start, not to complete. Now subconscious mind has no idea, are you going to complete it or not? So subconscious mind is confused. Then what happened? If some obstacle or some problem comes, it is taking chance to avoid it. Because subconscious mind wants to protect you. That mind wants to take away you from the obstacles. This is the problem happens. Most of the people, they don't understand this. Subconscious mind is so beautiful, so strong, that if you give a complete action, it will try to complete it. And it, in between also, if something happens, the obstacles are removed, or some way it is, something will happen. So this is smriti. So you plan everything well and give it to the mind, and mind is taking it fully. There is chances for changes. That is some other story. But you plan everything what you want. Then try to complete. The changes are inevitable. It is there. You cannot avoid changes. Changes are there. So when change is needed, that will also be done. So that is, we are surrendering some part of our plan to God, Almighty God. So that the next sutra, we are going to discuss that. So this is the important part of smriti. Even in sadhana, you must know the God, what purpose you are doing sadhana, and what is I am going to gain. Everything should be well planned. Now we are studying Patanjali Yoga Darshana one by one. So you must have a complete plan that I am going to study this much, and I am going to complete this. Then your willpower can work. Otherwise, you are like any other child. The child has no plan. Whatever happens, it just reacts. That's all. So we are not like that. We have a special developed brain. That is our blessing of God. So in what way God blesses you, God gives a good mind, good intellect, that you can think and understand and do things well. That is the blessing. So whatever you got is a blessing of God only. So use it. And if you are not using it, then what does it mean? It is useless. God has given you the blessing and you are not using it. It is something like this. Or you are misusing it. So take the responsibility of an action and do it. The responsibility is necessary. Then sincerity comes, then willpower comes, then everything works smoothly. You will not be disturbed by any obstacles. You will overcome all the obstacles in the way when you forward. Because the obstacles are removed by your own mind. And the obstacles are created by your own mind. No obstacle is an obstacle for him who is aimed to finish his action, what he planned. He will overcome that. So this is smriti. Without this, you cannot do any sadhana, because reaching some asambrajnada is a big thing. It's a long way to go. You need so much strength, mental strength. You are just fluctuating with the thoughts. No, it is not going to happen. So you must know how to plan an action and complete it. That is called smriti. This is mindfulness. Then comes samadhi prajna. Sometimes this samadhi and prajna is translated separately. In some editions, they are together. But there is no much difference in meaning. Samadhi prajna means the efficiency of intellect that you got from samadhi, practicing samadhi. You can say keen mind, a special mind trained by deep meditation. That is called samadhi. Like we are trained in computer science, we are trained in medicine, we are trained in engineering. Like that we are trained in samadhi prajna. So that mind is called educated mind. The samadhi educated mind. So that is samadhi prajna. Now you will have samadhi whenever you want. The super cognitive state of mind. So with this samadhi prajna you understand samadhi. Just to understand what is samadhi, you must have some connection with this samadhi prajna. Otherwise, samadhi cannot be grasped in mind. If theoretically grasping also, you must have some connection with that. So that connection is called samadhi prajna. So these are the sadhana. Shraddha, virya, smriti, samadhi, prajna, purvaka. With all these sadhanas, others who follow the systematic progress of sadhana, ultimately they get dasam prajnata. So then he is again talking about the seekers, because there are many types of seekers. Sadhakas are various in type with their ability and all those things. So he wants to give some more strength to the sadhaka if somebody is ready to do that. So have this all qualities and look forward. So he is giving more details. Tivra samveganam asannaha. Among those who are practicing systematic sadhana, tivra samvegaha, if some of them are very intensely practicing, if they have higher level of intensity, that is tivra samvega, the highest level of intensity. So then for them it is nearer, asannaha. Is very near. They get the result closely. That we know in all action it is like that. If you are very serious and putting all your effort into the action, then you get the result immediately, speedily. So tivra samveganam asannaha. So why he puts this sutra here? If somebody asks, I am practicing these things for many years but nothing is happening, you are talking about all happenings but it is not happening, what is the reason? So he is giving the answer. If you are a tivra samvega, for you it is near. If you are not a tivra samvega, not very intensive practitioner, then you have to wait, slowly progress. The slow progress is there. Progress is there, but very slow. Sometimes the progress is not seen, that much slow. that much faith. That is all. But it is there. That is what he wants to say. So, tivra samveganam asannaha. So, you won't find any change. But change is there, but it is very little that you don't find. So, you have to change yourself and be more keen or be more strengthened with your willpower and practice. For this, he is putting this sutra here. Then he says, not only this, in this also there are many other variations. So next sutra says, mridu madhyadi matratva tatra bivishesha. There are different readings, tatopi or some places tatrabi. Here in our manual, this is tatrobi, that is not correct. You have to correct it. That mridu madhya adimatratvat tatrabi visheshaha. That is one reading. Another reading is mridu madhya adimatratvat tatopi visheshaha. The meaning is the same. So mridu madhya adimatratvat. So those who are intensely practicing, among them, there are three more subdivisions of practice. That is mridu, very mild. The intensity is there, but very mild. That is, I said, just you cannot see if there or not. And then come madhyam, medium intensity. And then adhimatra, intense intensity, the maximum intensity. So then there is difference in this practice also. So now you analyze yourself with these parameters and try to understand in which category you are. So you are tivra samvega or mridu madhya matra, mridu madhya adhimatra. Then accordingly you will get the fruit result. That is all. Because he knows psychology very well, human psychology. That is why he is putting all these things. Because when we study about asampratnyada, we see it is a big thing, it is impossible to reach and all those things. So we may withdraw from studying this. So he's putting some pressure, he's making us on the way and bringing back. You just follow this, so you will get it. Because of these reasons, you are not getting. So now you have some inspiration that we can do it. Even though we are mridu, mild practitioners, but we can proceed. So the mild intensity, medium intensity, and maximum intensity. So mridu madhya adhimatra. Adhimatra tadobi visheshaha. Tataha or tatrabi. In those three tivra samvegas. Among them, these are the variations. So you see and find out what is happening. So now, regarding abhyasa and vairagya, the discussion is completed here. Now, right from here, Patanjali is going to give some of the alternative means to attain samadhi. Abhyasa vairagya we have discussed with Shraddha, Virya, Smriti, Samadhi, Pratnya, Purvaka, Itaresha. And Bhava Pratyaya. This is all connected to Abhyasa vairagya. And all other duties and practices which are helpful for practice of sadhana. Like in Bhagavad Gita you can see Abhyam Sattva Samshuddhi and all those sadhanas. You can adopt those sadhanas. So everything together comes under abhyasa. So he is just giving the word abhyasa. Specifically, he is not mentioning any of the sadhanas. So it means you can adopt all those sadhanas, whatever is needful. Now, then he is giving alternative means, because these means also were present in his time. Like in Bhagavad Gita, you can see many different sadhanas. So, Bhagavan Krishna collects all those sadhanas. They are useful for sadhakas. And he made the Bhagavad Gita like that. So those sadhanas were famous in those days. So he took it. The same way Patanjali also does. These sadhanas were there. So he is giving us an alternative sadhanas. Then the first one is Ishvara Pranidhana, is bhakti, devotion. Now we just discussed about that. So if you practice one of these, you get that Tivra Samvega, the first to attain the samadhi. So with Tivra Samvega, you can practice Sampratnyada and get Asampratnyada. Here, the sadhana is given for abhyasa, not for directly samadhi. For samadhi, you have to practice sampratnyada and asampratnyada in either way. With abhyasa vairagya or with this alternative sadhanas. But these alternative sadhanas will help you to reach there. You will get this tivra samvega, the intensity in practice. So this is the connection. There are some translations, commentaries, they say this Ishvara Pranidhana is direct means for asamprajnata. It's alternative with asamprajnata samadhi. Or asamprajnata or Ishvara Pranidhana. But not it comes to asamprajnata, because in between, Abhyasa Vairagya is there. So we were discussing about Abhyasa Vairagya. And related to that, the Bhava Pratyaya Videha Prakriti Laya came. Then Shraddha, Virya, Smriti, Samadhi, Prajna, Purva also connected to that. So Asampratnyada, if it is directly achieved by Ishvara Pranidhana, then Ishvara Pranidhana, you cannot define Ishvara Pranidhana. If you say it is directly achieved, then you cannot define Ishvara Pranidhana. He is going to define what is Ishvara and so. So you have to meditate on that. So you are thinking about Ishvara, the qualities of Ishvara, the specialities of Ishvara. So thinking that, how can you reach Chittavritti Nirodha? You cannot. So that is why it is impractical according to the sutras when we see. In Asamprajna Samadhi, there is no thought even related to Ishvara. We are not even remembering Ishvara. We are not remembering anything. If you want to complete thoughtlessness, that is complete thoughtlessness. So that is why you cannot say it is direct means or the alternative to asampratnyata. It is alternative to sadhana. So you get tivra samvega and then you can move very easily to asampratnyata. Because once you are concentrated, you got the concentrated mind, the vidarka, vichara, ananda, asmita, everything will be very easy. This way you can move. Okay, we take the next sutra. Ishvara pranidhanadvam. Ishvara, the Supreme Consciousness. We say God. Here really, Ishvara is not God. Because Patanjali is going to define Ishvara as a special consciousness. Special conscious being. Purusha Visheshaha. He doesn't mean God here, as the definition follows. So next sutra, the definition follows. So we have to say, it's a special kind of consciousness. In other words, we can say cosmic consciousness. It's cosmic consciousness. And you realize, you connect yourself with this consciousness by pranidhanat, by profound devotion, intense devotion. In the translation here, I find a word that creative source, the form of special process of devotion and letting go into the creative source from which we emerged. Ishvara Pranidhana, the coming of Samadhi is imminent. This creative source, there is nothing connected to this. So the creative source is a wrong translation of Ishvara here. Because in Yoga Sutra or in Sankhya philosophy, Ishvara is not a creative factor. There is no connection of creation with Ishvara. The creation comes from Pradhana. Here, the Sankhya Darshana, Sankhya schools and Vedanta differ. Vedanta speak about creative source, creative force. The Ishvara is a creator. But Sankhya schools do not say that. They say there is no connection with creation. Ishvara is separately different. The duty of Ishvara you can see in next sutras. What are the duties of Ishvara? There is no duty in create. The creation is happening in Prakriti. Only in Prakriti. Even consciousness has no action related to creation. This is a philosophical clarity. So this here, the creative source is Prakriti only, Trigunas. That we will see how it creates. In next chapters, we will see detail. But here, this creative source is not correct. And now, in Vedanta, they say Ishvara is a creator in different sense. That the Ishvara is defined Ishvara. That is not God. In English, what we say as God is not Ishvara there in Vedanta. God is a God. Sometimes they write God in different forms, different letters to identify this God is not that God. Anyway, people understand God as something mystic. So here there is no mystic God. So the God, the translation God is also not correct here. And the creator is also not correct here, according to this philosophy. So he says, Ishvara pranidhanadva. Ishvara has the, if you dedicate the actions to Ishvara, then you are free with your ego and your mind is free, then you can practice the sadhana very well. Your mind is concentrated. And what are the tools for that dedication? You will again discuss about that. So Ishvara Pranidhana, the practice. Here the Pranidhana, Vyasudeva translate as a special devotion. He says, Bhakti Visheshadva, he says. So special devotion, he says. Why he added the word special there? Because he wants to clarify, this is not a devotion in general. It's a special devotion that you know what the Ishvara is and you completely accepted the nature of Ishvara and you are one with that. That is the speciality he wants to say. Like Ananya Bhakti in Gita, that is not a general bhakti. That is also special devotion, Ananya Bhakti. So here he wants to say Ananya Bhakti, but Vyasadeva is not using Ananya Bhakti there. Instead of Ananya Bhakti, he says special devotion. Vishesham, Bhakti Vishesha. So that is Pranidhana, the surrender, the fruits of practice, place oneself to God, down to God, submit everything, whatever you think, whatever you know, everything, submit everything. And don't think about the result. Then practice. Now, the old practical problem is, we are doing everything and you are saying that you surrender the fruits, the result of everything and practice. This is a confusing factor, unaccepted but very famous. Nobody is completely accepting it, but everybody repeat it. Even me is repeating it. So we have to understand the secret behind it. The no result, or you don't wish for results and perform the action fully dedicated. I am frankly asking, is it possible? Anybody try to do that? Try to do that? Is it possible? No. It is not possible. If you are not trying to do that, you can say it is possible. If you really try to do that, you will not say it is possible. It is not possible and not practical. The problem is the same we discussed in the beginning of this section. When we try to do some action, we are planning it. We have our intellect, our planning capacities, imagination powers, abilities, everything is there, we are doing it. And we are planning everything what we can, we are planning it completely. We want the result, what we want. Now, where is the chance to dedicate? Where you are dedicating yourself to God? It is not happening. Now, it needs little time to understand. If everybody is eager to understand, I will explain it. You see, the planning and the result. Then the action. First we plan, then we act, then the result is obtained. This is the formula. Now we are trying to dedicate this to God, Ishvara. Okay, first we understand what we are trying to do. The dedication is happening before we plan or before we act, or the dedication is happening after the act, or the dedication is happening during the act. There is only three options. Now you see three are there. One, planning, action, and result. You can add one more, desire, if you want. Otherwise, planning itself is desire. Okay. So planning, action, result. So you are going to act, and you are going to dedicate also. So where, in which part you are dedicating? You are dedicating before planning, or before action, or before result, or after planning, or after action, or after result, or during the planning, or during the acting, or enjoying the result, when you are going to dedicate. You have any idea? Before. Okay. Any other answer? During the action. Okay. That is all. So during means we have three durings. One is during the planning, during the action, during the enjoyment, the result. In which during you are dedicating? Planning, action, or result? During action. Yeah? During planning. During the planning, before the action. Okay, during the planning and before the action. It means after the planning. Okay. I'm correct? After the planning, you want to dedicate. Okay. So, this is the situation. You see, we are not very clear about where to dedicate. This is what I want to prove. So we are all ready to dedicate, and daily we are chanting, we are dedicating everything to God, but we have not yet thought about it, where to dedicate, how to dedicate. There is no chance, if God wants your dedication to connect with you, God will think, where he is dedicating me? He just, every day he is praying that I am dedicating everything, but he is not dedicating. There is no dedication. It's interesting. Actually, what is the connection? Why we are praying in one side and we are doing something else? Because we are not connecting. Every day we are praying it, but there is no practice on it. If some problem happens, then we remember, I dedicated everything to God. Whatever happened, let it happen. What is there? Then the hands are up. Otherwise, really there is no dedication. So you see, now Bhagavan says in Gita, you have to dedicate your actions, result of the action towards me. Karmanneva adhikaraste ma phaleshu kadhajana. Kadhajana ma phaleshu adhikara mast. You cannot take your reactions, fruit of the karma. So that you give to me. That he says there. Now we take one by one. It may take little time to elaborate it, but it is very interesting. You will reach to the God and you know what is happening by this. It is very simple, but it is very, very, very serious, very interesting. So now we have three: planning, action, and result. So first we take as planning. The planning means desire, is connected to desire. If you want to dedicate desire or planning before planning, it's not possible. Because before planning, the action is not formed. You don't know what is you are going to do. The planning makes the form of the action. Okay? So you cannot say, I will dedicate before planning. That is not possible. And after planning, you already planned. Okay? Now, can we dedicate after planning? Then also there is a problem. Because when you plan, who is planning? You are planning. So you have your ego with it. Your I-ness is connected to that plan. And plan means that I said it is starting point to the ending point. You decided everything. That is your desire. So you have the responsibility, you have the connection with your desire. You cannot leave the desire. You cannot say this is not my desire. This is impossible. We don't say that it is not possible. So after planning, if you dedicate also, there is no process will happen. Because in that plan, that mental process, the thought process, which is completed, already suggested to the mind, is with the ego, with your desires. So I wanted to do this, I wanted to do this, this way, that way, and you plan everything, and you have planned, then the plan is ready. So now, how can you dedicate this? Because Bhagavan says, you dedicate me without ego, because then only you can dedicate. Then you have no connection with the result. That is what he says. Now, in this planning, I am planning it with my ego, my understanding, and everything is mine, then I am going to dedicate it. It doesn't happen. So the first is, because the plan is not ready, you cannot dedicate. The food is not ready, how can you give to somebody? So you cannot do before planning. And after planning, it is already spoiled. It is with ego, so also you cannot dedicate. And now the third option is during planning. During the planning, when you plan, then you can dedicate. It is possible. But it is too difficult. If you dedicate the planning itself to God, then we can say you are dedicating it. And Bhagavan wants that. You dedicate your plan when you are planning. So then, everywhere there is remembrance of God. In every step there is remembrance of God. This is not easy for a normal person. You cannot remember God or you cannot remember something else other than you. When you are using your intellect, mind, you cannot do that. You can do before, you can do after. But during the planning, it is almost impossible. Even then, we let it be there. Because we want to discuss more on that, the next step. Then take the action. So you planned, now you are starting to act on that. So before action, the same thing, the action is not taken place, you cannot do. And after the action, action is completed with the ego, the mind, then that is also not possible. And when you act, during the action, you have the aim as result. The result makes the action complete. So you are aiming the result there. Without aim, you don't do any action. You are cooking, you want some vegetables to be cooked. If you are thinking, no, if it is cooked or not, or what is happening, I don't mind, but I am cooking. So this cannot come. This is impractical. So during the action is not possible. And the enjoyment, it is almost impossible. The enjoyment comes just in a moment. There you don't remember anything. So after enjoyment, you already enjoyed. Now there is no meaning of dedication. And before enjoyment, the enjoyment is not there yet to come, so you cannot dedicate. So if you can dedicate, the real dedication is during the action, during the planning, during the enjoyment. That is the real dedication. Now you think just, is it possible or not? It is possible by difficult. Now you see, once you know what is happening, it will happen, it's on. Now what the Bhagavan says in Gita or here, dedicate the fruit to me, is very correct. Because the result is not produced by us. Result is not produced by action. Action is a means to produce the result. Result is not produced by the action. When I say means and the production, I have to explain it. You see, you are cooking. Cooking is an action. You want to cook something, some special dish. You started cooking. And first you brought things for that, and vessels ready, and fire is ready, and you put on the fire, and the vessel is on the fire with the material you want to cook. These are all actions. Before that you planned what you want to cook, everything you planned. I will bring this thing, that. You know everything, and you planned, and you measured, and you made a note, everything is ready. Now you started cooking. So what is cooking? Cooking is an action. What is the result of cooking? The dish is cooked. That is the result. Now you see, you did the action for cooking, that you collected everything and made it connected with the fire. You means you brought things and made it and kept it in a vessel, and vessel is on fire, and fire is on, and everything is on. In all this, you collected things, but the cooking is happening without your action. You put the vessel on the fire. Up to there, your action was completed. Now, the process of cooking, the fire enters into the vessel and it heat the material there, this is not in your hands. You understood it? So up to where your action was, you collected everything very well and connected the fire, everything you did. But the result is cooking, the material is cooked. So you want cooked material, but in between you have no action. You have to wait for that. So this is the completion of our action. Our action is not bringing the fruit. So fruit is coming after our action is completed. And it is coming its own. Because you cannot make fire enter into the material which is there in the vessel. You cannot do that. It is beyond your capacity. And if you say, no, I can do that, then try. You cannot do that. It will not happen. Fire has its own character and it is being cooked by the heat of fire. And now, that is one point. Now you understood up to where your action is. So your action is completed. Now you are getting the fruit. So now the fruit, the result, is made by whom? Made by fire? We can say, no, we don't bring God here now. So somebody is there. Okay, let it be there. But we can say the fire cooked the... That is the physics. Fire cooked the material there in the vessel. So you completed your action. Now your cooking process was done by fire. It means somebody else. Not by you. We want only this much. So when your action is completed, the result is given by somebody else. So somebody else is working there. Although you brought fire there, you brought gas cylinder, everything you brought. But the result was given by fire. Because in between, when the cooking process was on, you were resting. You were sleeping. Or you were watching TV or watching the YouTube in your mobile. So you were free. So who was cooking there? So obviously, fire was cooking there. Now you stick on this. You will understand how it happened. This is a wonder. Now, fire is cooking, okay? Now, who made this fire? Fire is made by you or all of us? We all collected our energy and we made fire. No. The fire is not made by you or all of us. Okay, again we go. If we make fire, okay, we can do. We brought things and we made fire. We littered the things there and we can say. But again, we made fire, that is okay. But who made the heat in fire? So, heat is not made by us. Fire is made by us, we can say if you want. Actually, fire is also made by us. But if you say that, then again we go further. The heat in the fire, who made it? That is also not by us. The heat in the fire is natural, we say natural. Okay, the characteristics of fire, the swarupam of fire. Now you see, without that heat, that cooking was not possible. Without that heat, the cooking was not possible. The material is cooked because of the heat that heat is not made by you, and so the cooking, the result of the cooking is not made by you. It's somebody else. You have no connection with that. You are free from that. There, the God says, the Bhagavan says, I gave you the result. And what is the problem? Because he is not taking our action. He is just saying, where you cannot produce, where you cannot produce the result, I am giving the result. So you have to accept, because you are free there, you are not doing anything. You are getting the result. So this is the point where we have to accept. The result is getting from somebody. In all action it is the same. I gave the example in fire, but everywhere it is the same. You are missing the last point where the result is produced. You are missing it. You cannot do something there. It is beyond your control. Now, we eat every day sprout. Another example. I told you, it is elaborately discussed. For days we can discuss on this, but I am just giving some summary of that, just to understand what Ishvara is, how we have to dedicate to Ishvara. Because we are all connected to yoga philosophy, we'll take the body-mind relation and then connect all this, how we believe in Ishvara. We have to believe energy outside us or connected to us. So now you see, you are eating sprouts. Every day we have sprouts with dal and all materials. For what we do for that? We take special dals, washed and kept it in water, dipped in water for 12 hours or something. Then take it out and bind it with the cloth or something. Then you keep it. So this much you did. Now the next day the sprouts are there. You see the sprouts out. So what you did is you put in the water and water is there and everything is there. So who made that sprout? That is not you. Can you say that dal made it? Dal made it, the sprout. Okay, we can say dal made it. Dal is there, dal made it. Dal can make it, there dal made it. This is that, see what we are seeing is dal made it. But who gave instruction to make it? So how it happened? And how the information came to that small dal which is insentient according to us? How it understood? Now I got the water, now I got this much everything, now I have to bring sprout out. How it understood it? If a small dal can make the sprout, how we are egoistic to think we are making everything, we are planning everything. So who planned for that dal? Who planned? Is the dal itself planned? No. So this is the reality of the creation. There is a space for the consciousness, the cosmic consciousness. We have to accept that. We falsely identifying ourselves with our actions and reactions. The false ego, the petty ego, is our identity.
So Bhagavan says, you forget this ego and try to understand what is happening. So up to where you can act, you act completely with full dedication, do karma yoga. Don't mind for what is happening. It will happen. If you kept everything ready, the cooking will happen. You made the dal ready for sprout, the sprout will come up. So you do actions perfectly. Then forget about the result. The result will come to you. If it is in a proper way. So here, everywhere there is a space for, in all action, there is a space for this consciousness. So when you understand this, that is the dedication, that is the bhakti, the devotion of God. Just believe in that. You don't give any form just now, for time being, don't give any form to that consciousness. Forms are just made for our convenience. There is no need to give any form. If you like form, you can worship form also for your convenience. But in reality, there is no need for any form. Just to understand each action. This is one wonderful thing related to outside things. If you think about yourself, now our time is over. We will continue this with next section. So when we think about ourselves, here also everything happening is like that. Now you see, the definition what Bhagavad Gita says is also correct. You do your action as your duties without any attachment. That is completed. Because you are doing the actions without attachment, you know what is happening. You complete your action with dedication, with sincerity. You want the result. Then don't worry about the result. The result is there. It will come. It may take time to come. Like you put the dal in that water and then it took some time, then after that also to sprout, it takes little more time, from 6 hours, 7 hours. So you have to wait for that. If you push the dal to bring the sprout immediately, is it possible? No. If you grain it, nothing is possible. It takes its own time because that modification theory works there. It goes to each cell of the dal and then that dal is sprouting there from each cell. The energy is produced. You can see when the energy is produced, when you touch with your soft hands, you can feel the heat there. The electricity is produced there. The heat is produced there. Then the sprout comes up. That is why we are keeping it in a cloth to maintain the heat inside. Then it gets the sprout there. See how it is happening. So each cell of the dal is informed with this. When it gets the water and when it is in that certain situation, then it sprouts. So the same thing is happening even in the stones and clay, in water, everywhere. This information is there. The same information is there in our body also. The same thing, there is no difference. The dal sprouts and we grow. That is all. In dal, the manifestation is sprouting and become a sprout and out. Now here,
this manifestation is growth. We are growing. The changes are happening in our body. The changes are happening in stones. Stones are getting old and older. There is a carbon test, you know, to know the changes and the age of the stones. It means the changes are there. And trees, everywhere it is there. It means the manifestation philosophy, manifestation theory is same. Everywhere this manifestation is happening. If your cells are informed, similarly, the atoms of the stones are also informed. The carbon atoms of the stones are informed. You have to accept that. So now we will think, what is this information all about? The information is knowledge. Am I correct? Information is knowledge. Correct or not? No? Yes? I can say yes little loudly so I get the answer correctly. So information is knowledge, no? Because you cannot deny that. You cannot deny. Because whatever you have in the name of knowledge, that is information only. You got the information from many, many sources. You think, I studied, I did PhD, so I am well informed. The same way, these trees and this environment around you is also well informed. It knows what to do, when to do. So this, if the information is knowledge, you accept it, then the knowledge is everywhere, you have to accept. Knowledge is there in each of our cells, our body cells, brain cells, heart cells, and all the cells. It is wonderful. And that the same information is there outside that is also communicating with you. You are communicating within that and it has its own information and it is developing itself, changing its character. That information and this information is one and the same. It is from same source. So now the information is equal to knowledge. And where there is knowledge, what we say? Where there is knowledge, there is consciousness. I am taking in some other way, it is totally new for you. So I am stopping it here with this much. We will continue in next section. It is something wonder if you could realize this. This is the connection, this is the basic philosophy of Sankhya philosophy and Vedanta. This is connected to Vedanta also, but we are basically moving with Sankhya philosophy.
Purnamadah Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudasyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva.